Welcome to ASHA's IAS Institute. In this video, we are looking at current affairs, bilateral relations. So from 1st July to 15th July, whatever bilateral relations related news have come up in the Hindu newspaper have been compiled together, concised and additional information added, and they are brought in front of you. This is first in our series. So all bilateral related videos, if you put it together, you can have a complete revision of bilateral relations at a go. So let's begin. So here we go. The first news item is PLA pulls back from Galwan clash site. So PLA stands for People's Liberation Army, which is the Chinese army. So this is basically between India-China. It's India-China relations. So Galwan clash site, Galwan Valley in eastern Ladakh, is where we had seen clashes between India and China. So there were 3 weeks of military clashes which took place. And now disengagement process has begun. So it happened after special representatives Ajit Doval and Wang Li spoke over the telephone. And they have resolved to solve the boundary dispute. We have a boundary dispute. India-China boundary is here is known as LAC, Line of Actual Control. So there are some locations where there are disputes and these need to be resolved. But what China did presently is they entered into Indian side of LAC. So Chinese troops have now in the disengagement process begun moving back. But they are not moving back to the extent that they had come in. So presently even in Galwan Valley in eastern Ladakh, the Chinese troops had entered much into the territory and we had this incident on June 15, the unfortunate incident in which the violent clashes resulted in 20 Indian soldiers losing their lives. So now Chinese troops have started shifting back. They have shifted 2 kilometers back from this site in Galwan Valley where the violent clashes took place. And another contentious area is Pangong So. So here also some tents have been removed by People's Liberation Army, Chinese Army, in the Finger 4 area. So if you look at it, you can see Indian troops have also moved back. They moved back 1.5 kilometers from the site of June 15 clash in the Galwan Valley. So this means they have created a buffer zone. Means Indian troops also had to move back. So means the area where they were patrolling, now they cannot patrol. So this buffer zone is off limits for foot patrolling by them for the next 30 days. So actually they used to patrol till point 14 before this standoff began. And in this disengagement process, they also had to move back. And now if the resolution of this dispute does not take place, then they will result. This is if the standoff continues and it is only the disengagement which is upheld, then India will lose major territory because they will not have the right to patrol those regions which it were patrolling earlier. So a solution is required here. And Pangong So, it is said it is one of the most contentious areas of the current standoff. PLA has moved 8 km inside up to Finger 4. Means in Galwan Valley, they moved 2 km back, India 1.5 km back. In Pangong So, China has not moved back, only it has removed some tents. And how much it has come in? It has come 8 km inside. So that's what, and India's, that is up to Finger 4. India's claim is up to Finger 8. But even PLA has moved 8 km inside already. So this is a cause of concern. You can see Galwan and Shyok rivers which flow here, they actually flood during the monsoons, and resolution of this dispute is required because it is not in the interest of either China or India to stay put during this time, this season as such. And it actually all started when China started objecting to India's construction of a bridge at the mouth of Galwan River. So in April 2020, India raised this objection and also it has now moved in, so in Galwan Valley. And another instance is in Sikkim also, where in Nakula, in North Sikkim, China has created a dispute as such. So in here, this region also, China is making claims. Also, it is said that China is the one which pushed Nepal. Nepal has also published new maps claiming areas of Lipuleh, which are in Uttarakhand region. So Nepal is also becoming assertive, and it is said it's China which is pushing Nepal. So on various fronts, you can see China is challenging India in the boundary region. So here you can see this is the map shown. This is the Aksai Chin region of Jammu and Kashmir. You should know this has been taken over by China. It has been occupied by China after the 1962 India-China war. So after that war, this region is with China. Then here you can see here also in the, this is the LAC line of actual control. The entire state of Arunachal Pradesh is claimed by China. It says this is part of Tibet. So this is also a concern here. So these are the disputed areas shown. We'll see another map too. You can see this is the Galwan Valley here where the clash took place. So this is the LAC. So Aksai Chin region is presently Chinese administered, which we show on Jammu and Kashmir map. So this is part of Jammu and Kashmir state, but since the India-China war, it is under China, and Galwan Valley lies here along the LAC. So this is the line of actual control. So between India and Pakistan, we have the LOC, and this is LAC. So here you can see the Galwan River flows here. The Shyok River and the Galwan Rivers flow here, and this is the Galwan Valley site near the LAC. And the dispute which took place is because of this road being constructed. You can see DSDBO road. We'll see details about this also. Here you can see. It stands for Darbuk Shyok Daulat Beg Oldi Road. So India was at undertaking construction here, which resulted in China protesting against it and entering into the territory also. So this is the first time since 1962 that Galwan Valley has emerged as a site of dispute. So this is the, and this is the Pangong So region, the Nakula sector in Sikkim too, which are other flashpoints highlighted. You can see Pangong So is also in eastern Ladakh, like Galwan Valley, and Nakula is in Sikkim. The next news is top priority to complete strategic Darbuk Shyok Daulat Beg Oldi Road. So this is the 255 km strategic Darbuk Shyok Daulat Beg Oldi Road, which is a strategic road along the border, along the line of actual control. And Border Roads Organization, BRO, has been undertaking construction here. Defense Minister Rajnath Singh has directed this work to be completed by October 2020. So it is said majority of the work is already been done. Around 45 km of blacktopping work is pending. So basically it was because of this border road construction that China started raising objections. So it was raising objections to Indian road and infrastructure development at various points along the LAC. And this road, DSDBO road here, it was having a road branching towards Galwan Nala. And this is said to be the specific point of objection which resulted in the present standoff since May 2020. So India is building 61 strategic Indo-China border roads. So they measure around 3,323.57 kilometers. And even the Parliamentary Standing Committee on Defense had been informed that BRO has completed 75% of the construction work on these 61 strategic Indo-China border roads. And 12 roads of these are said to be in Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh, and 3 roads even in Sikkim. So India has been undertaking construction work, and this resulted in the present standoff. But Defense Minister, as you see now, has stated that this work has to be completed by October 2020, means we are not stalling the work. The border road strategic road construction will continue. So here you can see, this is the Daulat Beg Oldi Road, this is the Galwan River. Here. So this is the Darbuk Daulat Beg Oldi Road, you can see. It starts from Leh, it is in Ladakh region, this is the Aksai Chin region of China, presently under China. So here you can see we have various plans of border road construction. You can see, so the 430 km bridge has been built by BRO over River Shyok also. So this is linking Darbuk and Daulat Beg Oldi in eastern Ladakh. So road construction, rail construction, even air bases construction are under consideration. The next news is China doubles down on claims on eastern Bhutan boundary, including Saktang Wildlife Sanctuary. So this is Saktang Wildlife Sanctuary, which is in Bhutan. But China says that this is part of its own territory, and it calls it a disputed territory. So this is in eastern sectors of Bhutan. So China has sent a demarche. Bhutan has sent a demarche to China protesting its claim. China actually went on to claim at UN Development Programme's Global Environment Facility that this Saktang Sanctuary should not be funded because it is a disputed territory. So for this Bhutan has sent a demarche. Also, you should know that the diplomatic relations are not there between Bhutan and China, and Bhutan is very much close to India. So boundary between China and Bhutan has never been delimited as such too. So China has started making these claims, and when it's making claim in Bhutan's eastern sector, this is very close to Arunachal Pradesh. It borders Arunachal Pradesh. So basically, now a boundary dispute has occurred between Bhutan and China also. So this is there when the boundary is not even delimited. We have seen the Doklam standoff. Doklam standoff was actually between India and China, but it was Bhutanese territory involved. But as we said, Bhutan does not have diplomatic relations to, and Bhutan has also maintained a discreet silence on its boundary negotiations with China, because there are no formal diplomatic relations. And Doklam, you should know, Doklam is in Chumbi Valley, in West Bhutan. So here you can see, this is the Sakteng Wildlife Sanctuary in Eastern Bhutan, which is close to Arunachal Pradesh. So the boundary dispute has occurred now between Bhutan and China for the first time. So they have been holding boundary talks. So Sakteng Wildlife Sanctuary, it has been funded by UN Development Programme's Global Environment Facility. And in June 2020, China attempted to stop it, claiming it's a disputed territory. But then this claim of China was not accepted, it was overruled. So this is it. Bhutan and India have formally demarcated their boundary in 2006. So that is there, but China-Bhutan boundary is not still demarcated. And the Doklam standoff, this is also to be revived in present context of India-China standoff. So we'll look at Doklam standoff also, and what lessons we can learn from that so that we don't repeat the same mistakes in the Galwan standoff, in present standoff. So here you can see, it says the government must not agree to de-escalate the situation at the LAC in Ladakh without an agreement on returning to status quo ante. So only for de-escalating, moving back is not going to maintain the status quo. The status quo which was there before the standoff began. The situation which was there before the standoff began. So India was at an advantage, but because of aggressive intervention of China, aggressive, aggression shown by China, what happens is China enters into Indian territory and then the status quo ante changes. So we don't get to go back to the same position or move ahead to the same position, you can say, because China has entered in. So the Doklam standoff lasted for 2.5 months, from June to August 2017. And during this time, expeditious disengagement had begun, and that disengagement still continues. Even presently, the Ministry of External Affairs says that the status quo has been maintained at the standoff point. Means the status quo has changed. The standoff point where Chinese had entered in. So from there, at that point now, status quo is maintained. So disengagement brought an end to hostilities between India and China. True. But it did not stop People's Liberation Army from continuing to enter into the territory and even making construction work here. Basically, it was the construction work which had taken in Doklam Plateau, which resulted in protests. So that time it was Chinese construction which resulted in protests, and China continued with that work even after the standoff. So this is there. You can see map access from Google Earth show that development of roads here, which is actually Bhutanese territory, has been continued by China from 2017 to 2019. So China's latest claim on Eastern Bhutan is actually a precondition, a pre-step taken before it claims East Arunachal Pradesh also militarily. So it's a point of huge concern. So that is there. So here you can see, this is Sikkim, Bhutan. This is the Nathula Pass here. Doklam Plateau lies here, which is claimed by both Bhutan and China. Then next is, India says Kulbhushan Jadhav was coerced. So who is this Kulbhushan Jadhav? You should know, he has prominently been in news. He was a former naval officer who has been arrested by Pakistan in 2016 on charges of espionage, means spying and terrorism. So he had been actually arrested from Iran. This is what India says, but Pakistan says no, he had been arrested from Balochistan, the restive region in Pakistan. So he has been under arrest and he has been sentenced to death by Pakistan Army Court. And actually India appealed to the International Court of Justice, ICJ, which gave its verdict in July 2019. And in this verdict last year, Indian International Court of Justice said that Kulbhushan Jadhav should be actually be given the right to appeal his death sentence. And as response to that, Pakistan actually passed an ordinance, you can see, in May 2020, that allowed Mr. Jadhav, his legal representative or representative from Indian High Commission in Islamabad, to file a review petition as such on the ruling of the Pakistan Army Court. So this can be appealed in the civil court now, means in Pakistan civil court, Islamabad High Court. But then Pakistan claims that Mr. Jadhav has refused to file an appeal and use his rights as provided under the International Court of Justice verdict. And India says this is incorrect. He has been coerced. He has been forced into not appealing against his April 2017 conviction by Pakistan Army Court. So there is a mercy petition also which has been filed on this death sentence. And Pakistan says that he wants to follow up his pending mercy petition and will not file an appeal in the civilian court. So India is of course objecting to it and saying that he has been coerced. So you can see, this is the entire timeline. He was arrested in 2016. He's been called an Indian spy, which India refuses. Even RAW, Research and Analysis Wing, has said that he is not their member. He was a former naval officer. This is there, you can see. And then finally in 2017, he was sentenced to death for espionage activities by the military court of Pakistan, the army court. And since then, you can see India has approached International Court of Justice against this ruling. And the International Court of Justice began hearing in 2019 and gave its verdict, as we saw, in July 2019, that he should be, Kulbhushan Jadhav should be given consular access, because India was not allowed to meet him, his family members and the consulate members were not allowed to meet him. So that consular access was provided to him after ICJ ruling came. So that is there. Even the execution had been stayed while before the verdict was announced by ICJ. So you can see it was 15-1 ruling at International Court of Justice. Means out of the 16 judges at ICJ, 15 ruled in favor of India. One lone judge, which was a Pakistan judge, one alone judge ruled against the verdict. As he had a dissenting view. And this about the weightage of International Court of Justice ruling, it means the global court has no means to enforce its ruling. But India may consider asking UN Security Council to impose sanctions on Pakistan if it tries to disobey the order. So that is the power that this ruling will have. Then next is Nepal blacks out Indian news channels. So there has been a dispute between India and Nepal too. We had seen the new maps had been announced by Nepal. And now Indian media as such has been targeting ministers of Nepal, and it has been said that it is because of Chinese influence that this has been done, that Nepal has become aggressive against India and it has been making claims on territories which are part of Indian territory. So Nepal now has said that it will not allow foreign TV channels that indulge in character assassination of its leaders, and it also said it will seek legal remedies against such news outlets. So all Indian news channels except Doordarshan have been blacked out across Nepal now. So this is the Kalapani region, which is part of Uttarakhand, you can see, but now Nepal has shown it on its map. So it's a tri-junction basically, you can see. It is not just between the boundary between India and Nepal, but also China is involved here. So it's a tri-junction. All three countries meet here. And this Lipulekh in Kalapani, where this dispute is taking place. Actually, if you look at the history of it, in 1816, there was a treaty signed between Nepal and British India. And that said that the boundary between India and Nepal would be the Kali River, which is flowing here. So, Kali River forms the boundary between India and Nepal. But then what happens is that how this Kali River is interpreted differs. So, Kali River and its tributaries are here. And Nepal's claim is that the river to Kalapani's west is the main Kali River. So means if that is the main Kali River, means Kalapani should fall under its territory. While India says that a ridgeline to Kalapani's east is the border. Means the river to the Kalapani's east, that region should be the border. So Kalapani should fall within India. So difference in interpretation has resulted in this dispute. Then next is India-Sri Lanka hold talks over debt. So this is regarding the huge debt burden which is there on Sri Lanka. So, India is holding close and constructive discussions with Sri Lanka because it has bilateral debts too, and India has also provided loans to Sri Lanka. So, it wants to reschedule this debt repayment. It is a total of $960 million which Sri Lanka owes to India. So, it wants that should to be rescheduled, as well as there are currency swap facilities under bilateral and SAARC arrangements on which discussions are also taking place. So, Sri Lanka has a huge external debt. It has taken loans bilaterally through multilateral organizations like SAARC and also international money market. So it has billions of dollars in debt. In 2020 alone, Sri Lanka is scheduled to repay $2.9 billion of its debt, out of which $960 million here you can see is to India. So apparently, even out of this, $1 billion is international sovereign bond, which is non-negotiable, which is maturing in October 2020. So how Sri Lanka repays it has to be seen. Also, it owes a huge amount to China. Sri Lanka already owes $5 billion overall to China. So it has been in talks with IMF, International Monetary Fund too. It is seeking a rapid refinancing instrument. Beijing has also pledged $500 million to help Colombo, to help Sri Lanka because of the pandemic presently too, COVID-19 pandemic. And also China Development Bank entered into a $140 million facility agreement with Bank of Ceylon too, of Sri Lanka. So that also is being provided, assistance provided to cope with the pandemic. But Sri Lanka is already under huge debt. So that is a fact. So here you can see the foreign debt composition. Sri Lanka's overall debt, foreign debt composition, you can see in that commercial loans have, which are shown in orange, have significantly increased over the years. And these are concessionary loans. Concessionary loans have low, minimal interest, and commercial loans have high interest rates. So that has increased significantly. And China is a major contributor to and providing loans to Sri Lanka. And this is not just a problem with Sri Lankan government. You can see other Asian countries also, India is not far behind, is having huge debt too. So the gross debt as a percentage of GDP is high in these countries. But then if it's external debt, then it is a problem. So in Sri Lanka's debt, you can see bilateral debt. India has also provided 14% of bilateral debt is from India. 14% of bilateral debt is from China. But if you look at commercial loans, 39% of Chinese loans are commercial loans. So that is there. Then next is Iran drops India from Chabahar rail project, cites funding delay. So this is regarding Chabahar rail project. Chabahar port, here you should already know it was in news that India has been provided access here. So here you can see India took charge of operations at one terminal of Chabahar port in December 2019. So the project which is in news presently is not the Chabahar port project, it is the rail link from Chabahar port to Zahedan. Zahedan also lies in Iran. We'll see the map. This is a 628 kilometer rail line for which India and Iran had signed an agreement 4 years ago. But no development had begun. The Indian side has not provided funding so far, and that is why Iran says that we are dropping India from this project because of funding delays. The idea was also to extend this rail line from Zahedan up to Zarand. So we'll see this actually. So you can see 4 years ago the deal which had been finalized was that IRCON, Indian Railway and state-owned Indian Railway Construction Limited, will be involved in this, will take part in this trilateral agreement which was between India, Iran and Afghanistan. So it would provide us an alternate trade route into Iran, bypassing Pakistan via Iran and further into Central Asia too through Afghanistan. This Zaranj-Delaram road in Afghanistan, you should know, we have already constructed. So Border Roads Organization has already constructed this road in Afghanistan. And presently from Chabahar port to Zahedan, this is the rail link to be extended up to Zaranj. So that was the entire project as such. But now India has been dropped. Also, you should know that Iran and China are coming closer. They have signed a $1 billion deal, billions of dollars in this deal. China is proposing investment in Iran. And why India has also not provided funding? The reason was for 4 years, no funding has come forth. That is a fact. Funding delay is a fact. Why? Because US sanctions had been imposed against Iran. While US gave exemptions from sanctions to Chabahar port, but then still there was difficulty in finding equipment suppliers and partners because everybody worried that they could be targeted by USA. So that is why funding delay was seen, and now you can see Iran has dropped India from this railway project. Also, Iran had proposed in 2019 a tie-up between the Chinese-run Pakistani port of Gwadar and the Chabahar port. So Iran has already been considering China to come forward. So this is also against India's strategic interests. So this you can see the advantages of Chabahar port. It is only 550 nautical miles away from Kandla port. So the benefits would be it will open up trade with Central Asia. It will help in easier availability of minerals from Afghanistan to India. Also other sectors like petrochemical sector, fertilizer, steel sector will get a boost because of trade relations. Then next also here you can see one more point is written that food grain export to Afghanistan will get cheaper. So we can export food grains to Afghanistan too. Then next is here you can see about India's presence in Chabahar, how it is expected to offset Chinese presence in Pakistani Gwadar port. But that is no longer the case now. India is moving away from Iran because of US sanctions and China is coming closer to Iran. So you see the port of Chabahar will be used to ship crude oil and urea, greatly reducing India's transportation costs. But that was the expectation. Railway line, as we discuss right now, from Chabahar to Zayedan, will give better access to Afghanistan to India. Also, this port, Chabahar port, it will link to international north-south transport corridor that will connect India with Central Asian countries. So now this is under dilemma because this would not take place as expected because of US sanctions on Iran and India backing out. And now presently India has also been dropped. So this is the entire timeline. Actually, India-Iran talks started in 2003, but till 2014, no concrete development took place. Then India's first major push for Chabahar port came in 2015 when an MOU, Memorandum of Understanding, was signed on this. And India sent its first shipment to Afghanistan via Chabahar port in 2017. And 2018, it took over operations of a part of Chabahar port and sent its first cargo to India also, to Afghanistan, bypassing Pakistan. But now, the further development as we see is China coming closer to Iran. Then next is UAE in support of open skies agreement with India. So this is United Arab Emirates, of which Dubai is also a part. So it is in support of open skies agreement. What is an open sky agreement? You should understand first. So open sky policy basically means an international agreement between two or more countries allowing passenger and cargo planes to fly over an area without restriction. So it promotes free market competition and, you know, competitive pricing. So it means you are allowing another country to fly over your country. So India actually has open sky policy with SAARC countries, neighboring countries, and those beyond 5000 kilometer radius. So nations within this distance need to enter into bilateral agreements, and actually UAE falls within this distance. So we have a bilateral air service agreement with UAE, and UAE actually wants India to revisit this policy. And it wants 5th and 6th freedoms of air to be bestowed on it too. But India is having concerns because then Indian Airlines will be threatened by UAE carriers like Emirates and Etihad. So what is this 5th and 6th freedoms of air? That also we should see. So here you can see there are various freedoms of air. The first one, first freedom of air, is right to fly over a foreign country without landing. So you can fly over. Second, here example is given like, a Thai airline. A Bangkok Hanoi flight which is flying over Laos. So this is there. Second freedom of air is right to refuel or carry out maintenance in a foreign country without embarking or disembarking passengers or cargo. Means you can land for maintenance purposes. Third freedom of air is right to fly from one's own country to another country. Means you can land in another country. That is third freedom of air. Right to fly from another country to one's own country by coming back. That is fourth freedom. So third and fourth freedom will go hand in hand. And fifth and sixth freedom, which is being spoken of right now, is right to fly between two foreign countries on a flight originating in one's own country. So flight originated in one country and you are flying between two foreign countries. And sixth is right to fly between two foreign countries to another country while stopping in one's own country for non-technical reasons. Means not for maintenance, but for other reasons also it can stop. So fifth and sixth is explained in detail also here you can see. So you're flying from one country to another and you can carry top people, traffic, cargo between two foreign countries on a flight that either originated in or is destined for one's carriers, for the carrier's home country. Right. So this is the image given here, you can see. And sixth freedom of air is right to carry passengers between two countries via the home country. So that is it. And this is UAE, a small country with, you can see, Saudi Arabia lies here, Oman lies here, a part of Oman is also here at the top. So UAE actually comprises of majorly various emirates. It's United Arab Emirates. So the biggest emirate here is Abu Dhabi, here is Dubai, and other emirates like Sharjah, Ajman, Umm Al Quwain, Ras Al Khaimah, Fujairah. So Fujairah, these are all emirates under UAE. Then next is, should Kuwait's draft expat bill worry India? So what is this? This is regarding Kuwait's bill which is under consideration before Kuwait National Assembly. So the idea is that the share of foreigners in the country's population has to reduce. Because Kuwait, you should know, in Kuwait, the percentage of Kuwaiti population is much less than foreign population. So out of the total population in Kuwait, 70% are foreigners, only 30% are Kuwaitis. The fact is that there are more Indians than Kuwaitis in Kuwait. So Kuwaitis are a minority within their own country. So the government wants to change this, and the plan which is under consideration is that the foreigners should be restricted. There should be a cap on percentage of foreigners. So it is said Indians should not exceed 15% of Kuwaiti citizens. Egyptians, Bangladeshis, Filipinos should not exceed 10% of the Kuwaiti citizens each. So such plans are under consideration. So of course it will be a concern for India, and it is also very difficult to implement such a plan. And this is not the problem only of Kuwait, but various Gulf Cooperation Council countries like Bahrain, Oman, Qatar, Saudi Arabia, UAE have this concern. And presently, during the COVID-19 pandemic, this debate has been renewed. It is said there are around 8 million Indians working in Gulf Cooperation Council. Out of it, 2.1 million of them are from one state of India, that is Kerala. And in 2018, India received nearly $4.8 billion from Kuwait as remittances. So workers work there and they send their money to India, to their family in India. So this is the remittances which we receive from Kuwait. In the year 2018, it was $4.8 billion. So here you can see this is regarding Gulf Cooperation Council, the nationals and the expatriates. Expatriates means foreigners working there. So here you can see how the nationals as such, expatriate population, in that expatriate population, how nationals have increased a little because of various policies, but still the numbers are low. So this is not a percentage, this is the number of people in millions. So that is it. Then next is EU India to meet on resuming BTIA, Bilateral Trade and Investment Agreement negotiations. So here you can see, you should know about BTIA. This is actually a FTA, free trade agreement between EU and India. And talks have been suspended on it since 2013. So now a revival of talks has been agreed on. We had a summit, virtual summit, online summit between EU and India. And here it was agreed to revive talks. A framework for strategic cooperation between EU, European Union and India has been agreed on, which will go on cooperation till 2025. So negotiators are actually quite far apart on BTIA, it is said, the Bilateral Trade and Investment Agreement, because Europe says India has protectionist stance. And European Union has basically reservation about the model BIT which has been proposed by India. So the model BIT, Model Bilateral Investment Treaty, which we have put forth as a treaty which will be a model for various bilateral treaties which we will have with various countries. So in this model BIT, the dispute mechanism emphasizes on Indian courts as where the dispute should be resolved. Because presently with various countries, we have seen that investors, it's an investment treaty. So when investors invest into India and they have any dispute, they drag India to foreign courts. And that is not in favor of India. So India has brought out this model BIT, which emphasizes on Indian courts to be used for dispute resolution mechanism. So of course, European Union is not agreeable and is not acceptable with this idea. So that is why model BIT is also a concern for EU, and the talks have been suspended on BTIA. So trade with India, actually between India and EU, is only 3% of EU's global trade. So EU says that this is far below what is expected between EU and India. And conversely, if you look at EU, EU is India's largest trading partner and investor. It accounts for 11% of India's global trade. So that is there, the relations have to be taken to the next level, and a trade investment treaty is important for that. So that is bilateral trade and investment agreement. So here you can see India is pushing for improved market access in European Union. What we want from Europe is better access to its market, especially in mode 1. Mode 1 of services, you should know there are mode 1, 2, 3 and 4 in trade relations. Mode 1 is basically people from India going and being able to provide working in the foreign country. So that is access in services. We'll see what is mode 1, 2, 3, 4, 2. So here, mode 1, improved market access is pushed for by India, mode 1 of services, and also mode 4. So mode 1 and mode 4 is what India is pushing for, and what EU wants from India is to open up mode 3 services. So what is mode 1, mode 4, mode 3 and even mode 2, we'll see that. So here you see this is mode 1, means this is an exporter country and this is buyer country. So mode 1 of services means services provided from exporter to buyer country. The service itself crosses the border. Like, you know, if it's related to management, consulting, or information communication technology, marketing. So service is crosses the border and is provided to the buyer. Mode 2 is consumption abroad. Services are provided abroad because buyer is itself coming to your country. Like, you know, tourism, travel and tourism, or for education purposes, or for health related purposes, the buyer is from this country is coming to your country. So that is services provided in the country where the service exporter is there. So that is consumption abroad. So that is mode 2. Mode 3 is commercial presence. Means the buyer is here and you, the exporter, actually has a presence in that country. Means if you are talking about India, so European Union companies can have their presence in India. So that is commercial presence. Mode 3, what EU is pushing for. And what India wants is mode 1 and mode 4. Mode 4 is movement of natural persons. That is, the supplier travels across the border. Means you can see the buyer is here and the exporter. So exporter is traveling across the border. Means various purposes, like, you know, trade, education. Again, it's the other way around. Here you can see the buyer is coming to your country and here the you are coming to the buyer country and providing services. Movement of natural persons. So mode 1 you can understand like BPO services, also BPO, KPO services, which from our country only we are providing to EU, like that. So that is mode 1. Only services cross border, the physical presence is not there. In here, physical presence is there. Here, the other way around is there. Mode 4 is the exporter itself is coming to your country, to the buyer country. So this is like India wants its people. Like here, we are providing services without moving, and here actually the service providers are moving into the country and providing services. So that is there. So this is mode 1, mode 4, which we are interested in, and mode 3, what EU is interested in, that its companies should have physical presence in India. So that is there. So now going back to BTIA, you can see, so this is what each country is pushing for. India has been negotiating this with EU for years now, and it has been stalled. Now it will be picked up again. Also, another concern which is there between India and EU is regarding data secure status. So India is seeking this data secure status from EU. So otherwise, existing data protection laws of EU will result in a huge cost of compliance for India. So this is also one concern, data security status for India in EU. And other one is regarding agricultural products from EU, like cars and wines and other agricultural products. All these products, if they come into India from EU, then India will have its commodities, agricultural commodities, been affected. And basically EU wants India to lower its tariffs on wines and spirits too, which European wines and spirits are quite famous. So it wants a market in India, so it wants tariffs to be reduced here. And of course, as I said, mode 3 is what EU is demanding India to open up, mode 3 services. So this will ease FDI in multi-brand retail, insurance, legal services, so that European entities can establish shop here. So these are various aspects of the bilateral trade and investment agreement which has been negotiated between India and EU. Then next, here you can see, this is regarding model BIT, model bilateral investment treaty. So this is a bilateral investment treaty which forms a model for having such treaties with various countries. So government wants to renew, various treaties have had been lapsed, and then after that India wanted to renew these treaties with various countries based on this model BIT. So because you can see the reason, as I said, India has been dragged to international arbitration by many investors. And treaty will be updated with new economic situation. The treaties which are already in place have completed 10 years and now are lapsed. So fresh negotiations have been proposed based on the model treaty. What this model BIT basically calls for is foreign investors should exhaust local judicial remedies before seeking international arbitration. And tax issues will be kept out of bilateral investment treaty. So basically disputes are related to tax issues. So India does not want tax issues to be covered under bilateral investment treaties. Then next news is India loses jurisdiction over Italian Marines case. So what is this Italian Marines case? You should know, it is actually two Italian Marines who have been accused of killing two fishermen in waters off the Kerala coast in 2012. And this case has been taken up by Italy in the tribunal, international tribunal of UN clause, United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea. And the tribunal gave its ruling presently in 2020, and it has ruled in favor of Italy, saying that they hold immunity, the two marines hold immunity, and they'll face trial in Italy and not in India. So India cannot prosecute them because Italy says that they are, marines are state officials exercising official functions. So under the international laws, they cannot be prosecuted under Indian laws. So India will not investigate the case. Italy will resume its criminal investigation in this case. So basically, the marines shot the fishermen, mistaking them for pirates. And Italy says that this shooting occurred in international waters. While India as such says no, this actually, and another part of the ruling which came, the adjudication from Permanent Courts of Arbitration of UN Clause Tribunal, the tribunal ruling which came 4-1, actually accepted India's claim that they have to pay compensation. So the compensation aspect of India's claim has been accepted. So they should pay compensation to the victim's family, the boat owner and the crew members. So this is there. Actually, India wanted the Permanent Court of Arbitration of UN Clause Tribunal to adjudge and declare that it does not have jurisdiction in this case, which was submitted by Italy. But no, the Permanent Court of Arbitration said it had jurisdiction and it gave its ruling. So this is there. So this ship was called Enrica Lexi. That's why it's also called Enrica Lexi case or Italian Marines case. So India said that it violated freedom of navigation rights under UN Clause. So that is there. This is the entire timeline of the case. You can see in 2012, when the Italian Marines on board Enrica Lexi shot down two fishermen on fishing vessel Saint Anthony, and FIR was lodged against them in 2012. You can see in Kerala, they were escorted to Kochi port and anchored. And here you can see the two Marines were arrested. Kerala police filed charge sheet against them. And Kerala High Court ruled that they can be held accountable by Indian courts and are not entitled to sovereign immunity. And Marines got bail and they were allowed to stay in Kochi. And Supreme Court ordered investigation by NIA and trial by a special court in the case in 2013. And Supreme Court later allowed the Marines to travel to Italy for 4 weeks. And at that time in Feb, when the Supreme Court allowed them to travel to Italy, in March, Italy announced that Marines won't return to India. And then Italy started the proceedings against India in UN clause. And then you can see Marines actually returned in April to file petition challenging India's jurisdiction over the case. And since then you can see they have been in Italy only. And the case went on in international tribunal. And you can see it finally in 2020, July 2020, the Permanent Court of Arbitration of UN clause ruled giving Marines, Italian Marines immunity. And the jurisdiction is no longer under India. Italy will prosecute them, but compensation will be paid by them. Then next is India to take call on Australia's inclusion in Malabar exercise. So this is the last news. This is regarding Malabar exercise, the bilateral, it's actually a trilateral defense exercise now, which is conducted between among India, USA and Japan. So this is a trilateral exercise now, and another fourth country is proposed to be included in this, so that all quad countries, the quad grouping which is there of four countries is India, USA, Japan and Australia. So Australia also wants to be part of this annual war games, but and India has got the request from Australia and it is going to take a final call on this. So India said it was open to Australia's inclusion in Malabar as an observer as demanded by Australia. But so far it had not accepted the demand because China has raised opposition to this. That this is militarization of the Quad coalition. The Quad grouping is already there at a political level. But if they take part in this war games, then it is a militarization of Quad coalition and China is opposed to it. So Japan and US both want Australia to be included and are pushing India to consider it. About Malabar exercise, you should know it was actually a bilateral exercise between USA and India, started in 1992. And it became trilateral in 2015 when Japan was included. And now in 2017, we saw Australia requesting observer status in this exercise, which India did not accept. And in 2018-19 exercise, Australia was not included. But now for 2020 exercise, which is also delayed due to COVID-19 pandemic. So for this, India has been pushed to include Australia by other two countries, Japan and US. And already we have a strained relation with China. We are seeing the border dispute. And let's see what India decides on. So this is the Malabar Naval Exercise. This is how it, when it was conducted last year. It was conducted in Japan in 2019. It's a 10-day war games. So here we end our bilateral series. If you like our work, please do like, share and subscribe to our channel so that we can continue providing you with such videos. Wish you all the very best. Thank you.